Hello again. Thank you for tuning into our video series Parallel Programming and Optimization with Intel Xeon Phi coprocessors. In this video, episode 2.5, we'll discuss the types of applications that perform well on Intel Xeon Phi coprocessors. I hope that this discussion will help you to answer the question, will my application benefit from MIC architecture? The high computational power of Intel Xeon Phi coprocessors is derived from hardware parallelism. Therefore, applications that benefit from Xeon Phi coprocessors must be able to take advantage of the parallelism available on the MIC architecture. In this context, it is useful to think of what we call three layers of parallelism. The three layers are data parallelism, which refers to the vectorization inside of every core, task parallelism, which refers to using multiple cores in a coprocessor, and the process parallelism, which refers to using multiple coprocessors or multiple compute nodes. In this video, we will only discuss the performance implications of each layer. Later in the course, we will have in-depth discussion and practical examples of parallelism optimization. Let's first look at data parallelism. Each of 61 Intel Xeon Phi coprocessor cores has 32 512-bit wide vector registers per hardware thread, which are twice as wide as those available on Xeon CPUs. By using vector instructions, you can operate on 8 double precision or 16 single precision values at once, which means up to 8 or 16 theoretical performance boost compared to scalar operations. Code optimization for vectorization is how you get to the peak performance of 1 teraflop per second on Xeon Phi, which is a factor of 2 to 4 better than on Xeon CPUs. Without vectorization, the theoretical peak performance for double precision on Xeon Phi coprocessor is only 126 gigaflops per second, which is only marginally better than the Xeon processor scalar performance. Those numbers are quoted for Intel Xeon Phi 5110P coprocessor and the Xeon E52670 version 2 processor, also known as Intel Ivy Bridge. Thus, for an application to benefit from the MIC architecture, it must be able to take advantage of vectorization. Next, let's consider task parallelism, or the usage of multiple cores. Ninth current generation Xeon Phi coprocessors have up to 244 threads across 61 cores. So, if the application does not have enough parallelism to keep every core busy, a significant portion of the computational power is wasted. Even if the application is fully vectorized but single-threaded, its theoretical peak performance on Xeon Phi is only about 8 gigaflops per second, which is worse than the 20 gigaflops per second on Xeon processor. To estimate this number, we accounted for the fact that Xeon Phi cores has instruction decoder, which is 2-cycle unit, meaning that with a single thread per core, only every other clock cycle is used to issue an instruction from the same hardware thread context. Therefore, in order to benefit from the MIC architecture, an application must at least be able to scale up to about 120 threads, which is 60 cores working with 2 threads per core, and preferably up to more than 200 threads to also take advantage of latency masking with 4 hardware threads per core. Finally, let's consider process parallelism. Naturally, process parallelism is a concern for cluster calculations, where just a few compute nodes, or up to thousands of compute nodes, can process a workload. However, with Intel Xeon Phi coprocessors, process parallelism may also be important with a single compute node or a workstation. At the very least, a system with one Xeon Phi coprocessor has two independent compute devices, the host CPU and the coprocessor. Thus, in order to fully take advantage of the whole system, each device needs to keep it busy concurrently with the others. On the high-end server part of the spectrum, you can have a single server such as a CXP9000, which supports 8 Xeon Phi coprocessors in a single system. In such a system, using process parallelism with MPI, or performing parallel offload to multiple coprocessors, is essential to take full advantage of all coprocessors. Another consideration in the question, will my application benefit from the MIC architecture, is the memory access pattern of the application. For this, let's take a look at this graph, which shows the result of the Stream benchmark. Stream benchmark is an industry standard memory bandwidth benchmark tool. This chart compares a dual socket Ivy Bridge Xeon processor to a 7100 series Xeon Phi coprocessor. First, we performed the Stream Triad test, in which large contiguous arrays in memory were read and written. The result is in the far left bar. As you can see, Xeon Phi with its GDDR5 memory technology outperforms Xeon processor with DDR3 memory by more than 2.5x in memory bandwidth. Thus, purely bandwidth-bound problems will benefit tremendously from the MIG architecture. However, this is not the case for latency-bound problems. The performance penalty for random access to the memory is far more severe on Xeon Phi coprocessors than on the Xeon processors. The middle graph illustrates this. Here we performed the stream triad bandwidth test on a large number of 4 kilobyte arrays scattered around in memory. Each thread would read and write a 4 kilobyte array and then jump to a random location in memory to another 4 kilobyte array. Although in this test both architectures get a performance penalty, Xeon Phi coprocessor takes an 8x performance hit compared to 2x for Xeon processor. This is because there are 8 memory controllers serving all 61 cores, and the prefetchers can no longer operate at maximum efficiency. For every new 4 kilobyte array, they cannot guess where the data should be prefetched from. The penalty is even greater when we increase the randomness of access. The graph on the right shows the stream triad test on randomly scattered 1 kilobyte blocks. In this scenario, our measurements show that Xeon processors outperform Xeon Phi coprocessors with more than 3x the bandwidth. Xeon Phi coprocessors were designed for one of the two cases. First one, bandwidth-bound workloads, where memory access is simple and contiguous. And second one, compute-bound problems, where memory access time is negligible compared to calculations. So if your application has complex memory access pattern, it may be latency-bound. In this case, the application is unlikely to benefit from the MIG architecture, but a multi-core processor architecture such as Intel Xeon may be a better match for this latency-bound application. To recap, applications that benefit from the MIG architecture must be able to take advantage of the all three layers of parallelism, and must have either a streaming memory access pattern or a negligible amount of memory access. As seen on those two graphs, Xeon Phi coprocessors are more sensitive to inefficiencies in hardware utilization and therefore less forgiving of suboptimal codes. In this course, we will discuss multiple micro-benchmarks that confirm that optimization methods are common for multi-core processors and the MIG architecture. However, this trend also applies to more complex real applications. To further illustrate this point, let's take a look at the optimization roadmap plot for a collaborative project between Colfax International and Stanford University. In this project, we optimized an astrophysical application called HEATCODE for high performance on Xeon Phi. HEATCODE computes the emissivity of cosmic dust particles illuminated by broadband spectrum of starlight. The workload is complex. It includes dense linear algebra and transcendental math, and also has components with scattered memory access pattern. Unfortunately, it is often the case that applications developed for Xeon processors and ported to Xeon Phi coprocessors will perform poorly out of the box. They must be optimized before their performance can benefit from Xeon Phi coprocessors. However, the key value proposition of the MIG architecture is this. Optimization for Xeon Phi will reward you twice, because generally, optimizing a workload for Xeon Phi coprocessors will also improve the performance on Xeon processors. To observe one of the many verifications of this trend, take a look at those graphs. We can see that addressing each performance consideration improves performance not only on Xeon Phi coprocessors, but for Xeon processors as well. This is a theme you will see over and over again in our video course, and this trend is one of the most apparent advantages that Xeon Phi has over other accelerator technologies, such as general-purpose graphics processing units or GPGPUs and field programmable gate arrays or FPGAs. Indeed, other accelerator technologies usually require platform-specific programming and optimization. Intel's James Reinder, senior engineer and educator for parallel programming, has expressed it this way. The single most important lesson from working with Intel Xeon Phi coprocessors is this. The best way to prepare for Intel Xeon Phi coprocessors is to fully exploit the performance that an application can get on Intel Xeon processors first. This plot shows the optimization timeline. The x-axis shows the different optimization techniques applied in steps. The y-axis shows the logarithm of performance relative to the unoptimized original code compiled with GCC, which is represented by the black line. Note that step 0 is also the original unoptimized code, but this time compiled with Intel compiler. Optimizations applied here include algorithmic optimizations, which reduce the number of operations, and optimizations that make the workload utilize the hardware capabilities of the coprocessors more efficiently. Those optimizations will be discussed throughout this course, and they include exposing task and data parallelism, optimizing the arithmetics in each vector lane, improving memory traffic, and controlling communication. The important takeaway from this graph is that at each step the performance on the Xeon Phi coprocessor and on the Xeon processor both improve. Thus, although the focus of this video course is on the Intel Xeon Phi coprocessor, the optimization techniques that will be presented are also applicable for Xeon processor. By training to program better on Xeon Phi coprocessors, you will also be trained for programming on multi-core general-purpose CPUs, including Xeon processors and on future many-core architectures such as Knights Landing.
Thank you for tuning in. In the next episode, we will talk about second generation of MIC architecture with the code name Knights Landing.